Mr. Peabody, where's the Wayback Machine going to take us today? Why, Sherman, we're going all the way to 1980. Grab your codpiece and get ready for the Mythwits, the show dedicated to all things geek pop culture, drenched in absurdity, and coated with sarcasm. Every week we bring you the news and interviews from the Geekoverse. We do our damnedest to be funny, but as always, there's no guarantees. I'm your host, Peter Bryant. Joining me this week, like most weeks, is my co-host, Mike Kafis.
I hit it with my sword.
Also joining me this week is my other co-host, Jack Ballard.
Hello.
And our special guest this week, Frank Mentzer.
Hey, good Frank. Evening.
Hey, Frank is a folk rock star. No, actually, Frank Mentzer is an American fantasy author and game designer, and he was once a folk rock star, best known for his work on early materials for the Dungeons & Dragons fantasy role-playing game. He is still working on stuff, but we're going to find out about all of that in just a moment. Frank, welcome to the Mythwits.
Greetings, Mythwits and Blix. Blix, jeepers, I finally catch up to you. We've been running into each other for darn near a decade up at TotalCon, which is coming up in just another month, and we just never seem to find the time to make this happen. So yes. Here we go.
I'm very excited. I'm very happy to have you on the show. It's been a long time coming. It's going to be awesome. There's two things before we start talking about, because everybody knows you for your D&D stuff, which is awesome and that's great. But there's a couple things that I want to talk to you about before we get into all of that, because I found them terribly interesting. And Jack, I don't know if you caught this one, or Mike, but Frank used to live down here in Maryland.
Get out of here, really?
Yeah. Apparently, the Wikipedia says that he lived at the help me out here, Frank. What is it? How was it?
Cacocton.
Yeah.
And Cacocton Mountain Park is part of the national park system, but they have so many doggone terms now. There's like a national river, a national gorge, a national, you know, this and that. It's not just national parks and national battlefields. So it's Cacocton Mountain Park for whatever reason.
Okay. So you were there when you were a young man, right? Your father worked for the Park Service, I think it was.
Well, he started working for the service in the early 60s, and within their ranks, he was an early radical. He insisted on things that nobody had else, doing things nobody else had done, like treating the secretary and the guy in the mailroom just like everybody else who worked in the office, because they happened to be a different color. Everybody was accustomed to, you know, like you avoid those people, et cetera. Dad wasn't raised that way. His mother was quite racist, and it may have been a reaction to that. But long story short, he started working with the Park Service, and he actually turned down transfers to serve in a park rather than a regional office in Philadelphia until I managed to get my high school degree. Diploma, and we moved, I think, within 5 days after I got my degree. So it was all balanced on that. He's very considerate of him, not so much so of my sister, who was stuck with bouncing around at three different schools before she finally got her high school degree out in New Mexico.
Wow.
But such is life for a Park Service brat. I'm especially proud of the service these days, saying what they believe in while obeying the law and yet speaking their minds.
Yeah, I got you. Yep, absolutely.
I agree.
Yeah, absolutely. Heroes.
So I ended up right after high school graduation arriving in Maryland. Got accepted at a couple of colleges, selected one in Boston, and proceeded to head out for that, really, for 68, 69. During that time, I got a little better at guitar in my goofing off hours first year of college. You have a lot of goofing off hours and ping pong hours and things. And my guitar work got better. And when I went back to visit Philly, I jammed a little with old friends who threw me out of a band called the Razor's Edge. If anybody from Springfield in the 60s remembers us, we played all kinds of gigs. But I was really bad at the time. Anyway, I jammed with him, and he was kind of blown away at how much I had improved. These days, I have a Les Paul standard and a good Fender tube amp, bluesy amp. To crank that through, along with a couple of acoustics and a variety of other instruments. I still keep my finger into music.
That's cool. Hey, Jack's a musician.
I'm a musician too. I got real excited when I heard about the Les Paul, and basically running that through a tube amp is the only thing you'd ever need. That is a classic setup. That's awesome.
Now, I'm a pedals kind of dude. I tried the Line 6 and the programming. You can get those things to sing however you want them to sing, but it takes a lot of work, I found, and my old instincts just fought against it. So I'm back to stomping forward pedals.
No, they're better. Those big pedals that have 400 effects, they're crappy. The effects don't work as well.
Well, you can do whatever you want. Yeah. I got one that emulates the sound of Jimmy Page during the Led Zeppelin era, that specific sound for the guitar. Anyhow, I diddled around with that through college, and in the summers, I started, since my father's park service, I often worked park service-related gigs. Traveled around playing folk music at the different national parks, for example. They covered gas and almost nothing for pay, but I got to run around and it was way cool. I'm a straight up guy, so I towed the line. I turned down tips, but I did accept drinks at people's campsites after the sing-alongs and things in the parks. So it was a lot of fun. As a result of those connections and through my dad, I got invited to join the Summer in the Parks program, I think is what it was called, in 72 or 3, and played along with a dozen other acts. One was a soul music band at a different stage, a good distance from me. They had the usual lame stuff like a mime and a juggler, and none of the kids were interested in that. But I had several hundred doing sing-along to old Peter, Paul, and Mary stuff. It was going along great, and I noticed something out of the corner of my eye, like way over here, and it was the microphone at the end of a boom mic in the front of a cameraman as part of a crowd, including the First Lady, the Director of the Park Service, the Director of the Secretary of the Interior, all these bigwigs, about 10 more TV cameras. And somehow, I don't remember this part, but somehow I just kept going and finished the song. And at the end of that, fully on camera, stopped and said hi to everybody and waved. And then they cut, and put that together in editing and ran that on the evening news. One of the most unusual events in my life, certainly, because I don't remember finishing the song. All of a sudden something happened. And then next thing you know, I'm howdying people. And they say, yeah, that was great. Well, I guess it worked, but... Wow.
Cool.
Hey, that's trippy. Well, that's the difference between a pro and an amateur like me. My sister's a professional opera star. So she and nowadays I have no problems with cameras and things either. I've done enough media. But back then, as a 23 year old standing on the White House lawn, quite a trip. Really.
Nice. And when you were at the White House, you guys played for Nixon? Is that right?
It was during the Nixon administration. Pat came out to meet us, and I shook her hand along with a couple others. Mrs. Nixon, Pat Nixon. Okay. But Dick was off doing something or other. I don't know.
He was not doing anything.
He was supposed to be rather busy, so we didn't fault him for that.
Did they record it, in the open air, or was it the under the table of, apparatus that Nixon was known for that recorded the performance?
Nice joke. No, it was standard media, boom mics, that sort of thing. Pro level cameras and audio equipment can be quite scary when you're accustomed to amateur level.
Yeah.
These are people who are really serious about what they're doing, and it involves millions of dollars in the overview. So it was just a very cool experience. Nothing I merited. I was there by accident. I happened to be the folk singer tapped for the event. Seriously, that's basically the way it turned out. Now, I did have a connection with music, folk music, then and later, and ended up, for example, having lunch with the legendary Pete Seeger sitting on the lawn at the Philadelphia Folk Festival and getting a chance to chat with him one-on-one for like 15 minutes, just out of nowhere, late 70s. Wow. I've talked to friends. They're not sure exactly what year that was, but he was that kind of a guy. He was a real scruffy fighter in the trenches, and he just loved it. We just sat and talked various things. Once again, don't remember a lot about that. Part of my life has been a little Forrest Gumpy, like running into Lyndon Johnson and having him tell me a dirty joke in the middle of Catoctin Mountain Park, things like that.
Do you remember the joke?
He felt like driving the caddy that day. And when the service gets that, it's, all right, well, you got to jog. Hope he doesn't go too fast, this and that. They have it all set. But he liked to drive his caddy around in the park. And he stopped to look at some deer or something. I was with my dad, and we went and checked out a complaint about some old guy who wouldn't move his car. And, it turned out, and so on and so forth. but got to chat with him for a little. Once again, just by accident.
Nice. That's like the time Mike and I were down at Dragon Con, and we're just sitting there, and James Randi is walking around. I don't know if you heard the Magnificent Randi is, but he's walking around, and looked like he was lost. And we said, hey, come over here, sit with us, right? And he sat down, and he talked with us for a while until his friend showed up. Or I think we had to go, right, Mike? I think it was. But
well, he had to go, but his friend had showed up. It was perfect timing. But it's just one of those serendipitous things when you're like right place, right time. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Pretty cool. So,
but the motto of that to me is that early on, I learned to get out there and dare and go places and try things and try and get involved. And then in the late 70s, when a friend of mine in my D&D group in Philly said, you really should apply for this job, I did. And I ended up at TSR, and my life changed, and the world of gaming changed a little bit accordingly. So it's easy. My wife and I still live by this. An opportunity comes up, we reach out and grab it. Yeah. Travel, events, you know, that's the way to do things.
Yeah, so you started TSR, that was around what, 1980?
January 20th, 1980. I was actually there on the 19th, and we didn't dare drive out onto the frozen Lake Geneva, although there it was. We played it safe and just walked out onto it. A friend of mine and I, it was a guy I'd known since Boy Scouts, practically, and through that period. And he was working as a cabbie in Chicago and picked me up on the train, drove me up there. And I looked around and told him, and I told myself, do you believe this? I'm going to work for TSR in the legendary home of Dungeons and Dragons. You know, I made it to the top.
Right.
You know, in a way, almost like Mary Tyler Moore, you're going to make it after all, you know, and throw my dice up into the air or something. You know, who knows?
Right.
But yes, that day on the nose. However, I got hired as a technician, as an editor, even though I didn't have much experience as an editor, a little bit in high school and college, but nothing to really shake a stick at, because somebody else better had applied as an author to be the writer's job. And I was no great shakes as either one. I was like, well, yeah, I do dungeons, you know. I design cool stuff based on what you guys published. And whereas this guy had serious talent, a guy named Tom Mulvey. So we shared an office there for the first few months until they were hiring people and buying more furniture and doing stuff like that, you know, in the early days. Yeah, January 1980, in depth.
Yeah, that's right about the time I started playing D&D. I was 10.
I was wondering if I made a mistake when they showed me the typewriter room. Right. They were still growing, and they had, I think it was 4 typewriters and more people than that, and a lot of them trying to write all at once. So they said the system was that you worked out your notes using pencil and paper or pen and draw your maps out and so forth, and you reserve time in the typewriter room. And after all that, I remember going home and thinking, boy, is this a podunk 2-bit outfit or what?
Wow.
Within a couple of years, we had Hewlett-Packard mainframe with workstations, you know, well, a few years. But so they were ready to grow. You know, the money was there and the intent. But I happened to get in at that kind of ground floor level when they were actually sharing typewriters.
Sharing the typewriter room. That's awesome. That reminds me of when I first got into engineering and I was a draftsman, and they had a CAD room, and in the CAD room there were 6 computers, and they were 286s, and the head guy had this brand new 386, and it was all the rage. And that was it. And if you were assigned a CAD station, you could work at it. Otherwise, you'd have to like go in during, like I went in during lunches and after work and stuff and learned how to use it. And then once I had moved on to being able to use the system, I got assigned a station. So it's pretty cool. But that's funny. The good old days.
That is funny.
So when you started with TSR, what is the first thing that they had you, first like kind of product that had you work on? I know you said you were editor, but like what was the first thing that you worked on that was like yours, like your thing?
I was a rank and file editor. Within that vein, I had to learn the ropes, because like I said, I'd never done any editing. Almost got fired when they said to check all the spelling and everything on this card game, or the cards for this game called Dungeon. The classic Dungeon board game. They were doing it in this new larger box version instead of the old little one. And I checked everything over and everything was cool. I gave it the go ahead, but I almost got fired because the cards on one sheet were this way and the other sheet was oriented this way. And I didn't know about registration marks and how you'd line the sheets up to verify that they were laid out on the paper right. So if they had gone to press, part the cards would have had part of one and part of the back, you know, overlaid, if you follow me. Would have been totally hosed. They caught that one. But they yelled at me, and somebody stood up for me and said, look, he's really new, and he doesn't know the first thing about this. He'll learn. Right. He's smart. Go with it. My first published work was The Chapel in Module B2, Keep on the Borderlines, by Gary Gygax, of course. When he sent that over, and that was my first meaty, real editing job of something important. And I went through that, and it was just clean up grammar, spelling, actually don't change anything, words, you know, spelling-wise until you check with us, because Gary has this weird archaic vocabulary and reference books, and also anything you don't understand, come ask, don't jump to conclusions. And I pointed out at one point that the Keep on the Borderlands referred to two different clerics but didn't have a place where they worked. No church, chapel, nothing, you know. And shouldn't there be one? Shut up, sit down, grammar, spelling only, don't worry about it, et cetera. And in my spare time, in my best imitation at High Gygaxian, since Gary was everybody's idol at that point, a lot of us could, I wrote up a chapel. Sent it over by interoffice mail, and they almost, not quite, but almost got ready to throw my going away party because nobody had ever done something like this to a Gygax manuscript. You don't send them a note saying, you screwed up. Here, you want to put this in to fix it? The thing came back with a few minor corrections, but with Gary's scrawled G on it saying, looks good. Yep, missed this. Use it. And everybody was like freaked. I had my interview with him as a new employee about a month later. Things were that crazy and busy at the time. And he was looking me over. Oh, you're the one who had the balls, huh? Well, good work. And I've used this cleaned up story to explain to kids why anybody, any idiot can pick at something. Lord knows you see that enough nowadays, and Facebook and other social media just magnify it. But the ones who stand out propose solutions in addition to picking at things. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this is how you get somewhere in the world. And that's what I did there. Instead of just picking at it, offered that. And look what happened to me. Gary and I became friends. They gave me a few other character and ability tests, like dropping me in front of a camera at the Jerry Lewis telethon that 1980, that September. But they eventually asked me to start implementing this game club that the game's general manager, Mike Carr, the legendary Mike Carr, who invented Fight in the Skies and various other games, has been to every single Gen Con, the only person to do that, et cetera. Anyhow, he had proposed this club, this RPGA, the Role Playing Game Association. So I added a lot of frills, fluffed up the bare bones idea, implemented that, and kicked that off and ran that for a couple of years. And finally, Gary said, all right, I'm pulling you. I want you to work on the D&D game, the flagship, the core of how this company started and everything. And I said, oh, crap. Do I have to? Because everybody was piling onto AD&D at this point, you know, call it 82, all sorts of stuff happening, dynamite hot projects. We had hired this weird guy from out west who we thought was going to be a minister or something. They said he was a Mormon. And then in walks Tracy Hickman with these just drop-dead ideas like the Dragonlance series and then Ravenloft and all this other stuff. So a lot of changes, a lot of progress, and especially in the AD&D line. And, oh, do I have to? Well, it turned out to be the best thing all the way around. Right. Gary worked closely with me, of course, on Redbox, almost line by line, word by word, looking at nuance and implications, not far more than just what the word said. And that turned out fairly well. And afterwards, they said, yo, by the way, we're going to translate this into all 12, 14, 16 languages.
Right.
Thanks for not telling me that beforehand. I probably
no pressure.
But then was blessed to be able to complete the whole line, even after finishing Masters and Immortals after Gary was forced out in 85. And then leaving in 86 to try and help him start New Infinities, which didn't work out nearly as well, mostly due to lack of funding and good management. Gary was an affiliate and the owner of most of it, but he hired presidents to run it. And they were the guys who just didn't make it work, really, if you want somebody to point at. But it's all water under the bridge now, and that was the late 80s. And Gary was looking for what to do next. He had this game, new game he had written. He dedicated the first adventure to me, even something called Necropolis. So Dangerous Journeys was published by Game Designers Workshop. And when he was working on that, I said, hey, boss, you want me to? It was sort of friend and boss, depending on where we were, what we were drinking, you know, et cetera. And but at the time, hey, boss, you want to, or is that our next one? And we had a chat. And he said that she was going to keep lobbing grenades. But he felt he could weather it, and I couldn't. And he wanted to make sure I knew that he wouldn't feel it the slightest bit against me if I split, got out of the target range, go off and did something else for a few years. So that he said, I've been talking to this guy named Dave Newton. I don't know who he is, but he's the listed co-author of Dangerous Journeys, printed by Game Designers Workshop. It's a very nice job, an excellent game system. And sure enough, the lady kept throwing lawsuits and things and drove Gary down until he ran out of money. Yeah. Meanwhile, I was off gallivanting doing other non-game stuff. met a new lady, got divorced, met a new lady, got married, moved up to the Wisconsin Northwoods and ran a commercial bakery with three locations, one of them a mall coffee shop and two strip mall type, or one strip mall, and then our main headquarters place, which attracted visitors just to look at it, just for its coolness, let alone eat the stuff. Did that for 8 years and saw the warning signs coming of the financials, so we opted out, moved down with my wife's father during his last year and a few months. So the timing there was great. She got to see him every day of his last year. And then once that was all over, I proceeded to start having ideas in 2011 at putting together another game company and called up some old friends. The legendary Jim Ward, who I first got to know in 1980 on one of my first game conventions I ever went to while I was at TSR out in West Virginia. Also got a chance to work with Tim Kask, who I had never known before, but started getting to know him a few years before this, helped bring him back into the Gen Con experience and things as friends. And he's still doing great, and we still hang out regularly. And another guy that Gary had worked with closely named Christopher Clark of Inner City Games, and he was willing to put his whole company on hold to do our production side and write stuff with us and so forth. Well, we gave it a shot for 4 years, but that really didn't work out all in all. And looking back, you see that you put together four guys who are all used to doing their own thing and running their own companies. Jim had Fast Forward Entertainment. Tim had his own Adventurer Magazine, Venture Gaming. I'd run a bakery, for gosh sake, you know, with 35 employees. Not the quality side. That my wife handles all the recipes and the real baking. I'm the taste tester and the business dude. That's the dangerous stuff.
That's the good side, yeah.
Hey, it's sort of the best and the worst. That bakery period ended up biting me as soon as I started New Infinities or started Eldritch Enterprises, and I had a heart attack in early 2012. Jim had one in 2011 and was recovering, and the 1-2 punch is another factor that really knocked Eldritch on its butt, really, right out of the gate. So we're proud of the products we produce. There's a dozen of them or more. There's an outstanding science fiction series. Mostly by Jim, with input from Tim. Tim Kask actually wrote some science fiction here, folks. Wow. If you're fans of Tim's Dragon Magazine editing and his articles and various other things, this is, as far as I know, his only published science fiction work. I'm not going to tell you which. Go to Drive-Thru RPG, look for the Dark series from Eldritch Enterprises. We're a listed publisher, but there's three different products about the Dark.
Okay.
The Dark Visitor, Dark Colony. Anyhow, you'll find out. Go read it. And it's all way cool. It's intensely Wardian lethal. That was like our final hail and farewell before moving on to other things. Jim never stopped writing for other folks during Eldritch. He's so prolific, just so full of ideas. Pick a publisher he's worked with, Castle and Crusade stuff, with Goodman Games, it goes on and on. There's been reprints of his classic Metal Alpha stuff. Tim has written a surprising amount of adventures, that most of which has only been available through the North Texas Role-Playing Convention. And these little digest-sized jobs have become like super collectibles, easy, 100-plus for one of these little adventure booklets. Because he had produced so little, and yet he created Dragon Magazine. He helped start TSR. Wow. He was one of the original five. With Gary and now Dave Arneson was a great guy, but he never actually came and worked at TSR. Right. He hung out there later for a bit, but the folks who started TSR were Gary and Brian Bloom, Dave Sutherland's buddy, two buddies, Mike Carr and Dave Sutherland. That's where Dave Sutherland came from, folks, from the Minnesota crew and the Arneson gang. And then this wild card, this old Navy dude, shouldn't say old, he was young at the time, this Navy vet who was trying to get some college in after the Navy, hanging out down Southern Illinois University, or wherever it was. Yeah, I think it's Southern Illinois, Carbondale, in any event, named Tim Kask. And so he's part of the first five group, and I've been honored to be able to suck Tim's brain for all sorts of details of the early days, what it was like then, what Dave Trampier was like, who I never really met. But oddly enough, although Tim and I overlapped for about 4 or 5 months at TSR in our employment, I started and then he left, we never got to know each other then, because TSR had grown so much, the magazine people like Tim were over in the Dragon Magazine building, where I was in the old hotel, second floor, with designers and editors, and then RPGA and Gen Con and all that stuff. And Ernie Gygax and the Dungeon Hobby Shop, Mail Order Hobby Shop, all sorts of fun. In brief, is my gaming history.
Hey, I was going to say, I would absolutely testify to your wife's baking abilities. Mike Cavis and I were at your party last year at GaryCon. It's a shame we won't be there this year. We can't make it to GaryCon this year, but we were there last year, and we came by your house for the for your pre-party that you have, and the cake that she had was awesome. It was very, very good.
All the food
was wonderful. Well, I say, we had a commercial bakery, and it did well enough to have 30-odd employees. So, yeah. And she selected or designed all the recipes for it. She trained every baker we had. You know, that's my wife. Yeah. At the moment, she's starting a different company involving knitwear and high fashion, you know, like spending $1,000 for a sweater because it really, really is worth it. You know, imported wools and high-end this and that. So, moving on to other versatile things in her career.
That's fantastic. Cool.
Well, hey, Frank, you had you did have a little bit of a writing career. I noticed you had a Cam's Cooking Without Fire, and another book.
You ran across some of those, yeah.
Yeah, I did. Trust at the Gaming Table. So you did have a couple books out that you did that were not particularly.
Yeah, after New Infinities folded, my wife Penny Petticord, who was RPGA coordinator for a time back in the 80s, who is now Mrs. Skip Williams. The legendary author of parts of D&D, you know, 2-something and 3 and onward and various products. They're happily married on a little farmstead here somewhere in Wisconsin. And more power to them. Glad it worked out. Mm-hmm. But back then, she and I, having both worked for Gary at New Infinities, both got laid off at the same time and went through the young marrieds and in financial trouble thing, which can tear apart marriages, etc. I mean, that's the nut right there. Yeah. And in working through it, it pretty much did tear us apart. By 92, we split up. But during that time, she found a gig where we could both write resumes out of a formal office. And we did some stuff like that. And one day this guy came in, and an older guy, Asian heritage, but not severely, you know, just nice little tinge there.
Yeah.
Obvious multi-generational here, etc. It turns out he was a demo guy for early microwave ovens for a major manufacturer of those, north of Milwaukee. And he wanted to write a book on how great it is, using microwaves. It's not radiation, Right. Like a lot of people were all spooked, you know.
Right.
You'd have to have been there to understand that this gadget that we now take for granted, like in 20 years, we'll take for granted the 3D printer over in the corner. Yes. You know,
yeah. Right, exactly.
But here's this new thing called a microwave. Some people are, you know, weirded out by it. You put some stuff in it and it sparks some things, you know, like aluminum foil. Do you need to preheat it? Well, no. So I dug up an artist from the area to do some illustrating, and he was very happy. Unfortunately, we had limited budget, so it is a very limited budget product. I wanted to do a much better full-blown professional job. The artist I selected is an old friend who actually goes well back with TSR. Do you have a copy of Kamikawa's Cooking with Fire?
Or no, I just noticed the cover of it, and it's
very simple. The artist there is named Stephen Sullivan, or SDS, Steve Sullivan. When I started the RPGA, I had some different ideas, and I called Steve in, and he was at the art department at TSR, and I said, I want a 3D-type map instead of the plain old. And I described it because this my first dungeon I had done had these different levels within it. Mm-hmm. So module R1 to the Aid of Falx has... published 1981, has the first 3D dungeon maps in TSR's published product line.
Okay.
The art department said, this is hot stuff. We love this idea. And in conjunction with, especially with Tracy's Ravenloft, you see some of the most killer 3D exploding maps that anybody had ever seen at that point.
But it all started amazing.
With this guy, Steve Sullivan, who did the art for Paul Kamikawa's Cooking with Fire.
Oh, okay. Dude, when I first saw that Ravenloft map, the first time, I didn't have a copy of the module. A friend of mine had it. And you know, after we played it, he let us look through it. And when I was looking at the map, I was blown away. I was like, I've never seen a map like this before. This is awesome. And it explains
it. But now you know how the art department got the idea. It was from RPGA, and it was from the work of their fellow artist, Steve Sullivan. Whose work you see before you there with this stupid cookbook. Now, I'm sorry, you're the family. It was a very nice book, and it expressed Paul's sentiments very exactly. And he was reasonably pleased with it, but it was really a fairly low-grade one-off as publishing efforts go.
I see. Well, okay. That's cool.
I think I have one, maybe two copies lurking in my files somewhere, but that's about it.
Yeah, we were at your house.
Skeletons lurking that you found?
No, that's it. That was it. It was just the Cooking with Fire and the Trust at the Gaming Table was the
yes. Ran into a lovely gal, Anne Dupois, who had a company, Grey Ghost Games, coming out of New England. And she invited me and many others to take part in a book two of something she had done, explained it was this book of advice for game masters. So, okay. So, we had pretty much carte blanche as to what to write. My essay was more about the social side of hobby gaming rather than any mechanical tricks or, you know, you can go on forever arguing about or discussing various elements of the game. Instead, I've talked more, as I recall, it's been a few years since I read it, about what the game master is implicitly promising the players, what they're implicitly promising a game master, and everyone to each other. And you're trusting each other to fulfill those implicit promises. Things like, no, don't spoil everybody's evening because you had a bad day at work. You know, figure out how to leave that at the door, right? For everybody, for the group. Various other things. The game masters don't do these nasty trick things because they're unfair and it's cheating, and players don't pull this stuff because, you know, there's a lot of implicit promises here. So I just itemized some. Still in touch with Grey Ghost and Anne to this day. She's a horse nut living with her husband for many years now up there in Massachusetts, I believe.
Cool. Yeah, I like to call that the, and I'm not the only one. I didn't make this term up. I'm not even pretending to make this term, but I call it the social contract that you make with your group. You know, we have this agreement, this contract that we all agree to, that this is how we're going to play the game, and it that way everybody knows what to expect and they all can enjoy a good time.
Now I have met so many thousands of hobby gamers all over the world, and I've been blessed to have been kind of stapled onto the side of a precious memory as a hanger on here, like a useless appendix. But people come to me and say, in my formative years, I met people and we became friends, and all our heads blew open all the same time and all in the same way. And in experiencing this, this established this bond, this brotherhood of gaming. And we don't, Frank, I hate to tell you this, but we don't really play your game much anymore. We're doctors and lawyers and Indian chiefs. Literally, I ran into a CEO who was opening a branch in Italy, but he was from India. So he was an Indian chief, literally. it was just amazing. And all of them look at me as associated with this precious time in their hearts, in their minds. And it wasn't me. I happen to be the name on the thing. It was what Redbox achieved. It was the creation of Gary Gygax and Dave Arneson and the many who came right behind that. You just can't list them all. I've been blessed to be recently be able to get to know Mark Miller a little bit, who invented Traveler, which was such a crucial influence on me in the 70s. And it turns out he was like only my age when he was doing this stuff, because I was a late bloomer. But I've been so lucky to have facilitated this for so many people. But I didn't create that. You did. You did at the table using the magic that I took part in communicating to you, that Gary did, that so many of us, that Blix and the crew here are communicating to you and so many others through this medium, all in our own little ways. I played my role along the way.
Yeah. You know, it's
so
funny.
It's been very cool.
Because I'm, you know, I very traditionally cut my teeth on Dungeons & Dragons. In 1980, there was a library in my neighborhood on my way to school, and I walked past it, and they had a D&D club. And my brother, who's 10 years older than me, had come back from college in 1979, because I moved up to Baltimore from Florida. He came back from college in 79, and he told me about this crazy game he was playing in college called Dungeons & Dragons. And it stuck in my head, and I was walking past the library, and I saw the sign in the window for the Dungeons & Dragons Club, and I was like, well, I got to do this, right? So the Saturday, it said Saturday, so the very next Saturday, I went to the library, I went down to the club, and they let me play. They were generous because I was probably the youngest person at the table. I was 10, they were all teenagers. They killed me a lot. They treated me badly, but it was sort of like an initiation rite, you know. But then, you know, and it's funny too, because I think by the time I was like 14 maybe, I pretty much stopped playing Dungeons and Dragons altogether and had moved on to other games. I'm very careful to say this, because I've said this before on the show. I don't consider it moving up. When I say move on, it means it's like a lateral thing. I moved to other things, but it wasn't above or below or anything like that. But it's funny because Mike cut his teeth on. What was your game?
RuneQuest?
Cyberpunk. Cyberpunk, yeah. Mike cut his teeth on Cyberpunk. That was his entry, yeah. So
Pondsmith,
yes. So we go to TotalCon the first year that Mike Pondsmith is there, and Kavis is like, oh, right. That's his gaming guru to go to. And tell him what happened. So you meet Pondsmith for the first time, right? Your guru, and what does he do?
Great guy.
Gives me the shirt right off his back.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Cyberpunk. Yeah, literally, he had the Cyberpunk, 2027 for the video game, and I was like, oh my god, I love that shirt, and I had been pining over wanting this video game to come out. It still isn't out yet, but we won't talk about that, but yeah, it was an amazing thing that he, at the end of the conference, he said, come here for a minute. I felt like the little kid in the Coca-Cola commercial.
Like me, Joe!
Yeah, when your kid can catch, and I was just like, and even though I at the moment I swore like I'm never gonna watch this, and then I thought that was kind of creepy, so I did watch. And I only wear it on special occasions, so I will be bringing TotalCon. So that's
hey, Mike's gonna be there.
Yeah.
So that's awesome.
Yeah, I don't know if you're on a tight schedule. I had some additional comments on that last topic.
Yeah, go ahead.
Cool. Yeah.
Okay. No man, this is your show, buddy.
I as I mentioned back in a book called Game Master Secrets, Volume 2 from Grey Ghost, I wrote this essay about trust and the esoterical side of social, you know, the thoughtful, erudite, you know, a collegiate look at the relationships and the concepts instead of, I just want to kill something, damn it. Right. And I've certainly game mastered enough games for full-grown adults with wives and kids, etc., who want to just get together and kill something, and they don't want to overanalyze or really look at the gaming experience, you know, from seriously, etc., leaving that to others. And that's cool. There are so many different sides to the experience. It's open for everybody. I was heartened when another old friend, Wolf Bauer, going back to the 2E days, really, long history in gaming. He gives me a buzz. We, you know, we run into each other at cons a lot. I don't get out Seattle way that much, but I do occasionally. And he gives me a call, says, we're doing this book. I like to have an essay. And it gives me an opportunity, once again, a book of tips for game masters and things. And I went back to the same topics, talking about this, the deeper side and the social compacts. Because we've learned, one of the things we've learned hugely, I have personally, and I know most of America has, over the last 30 years, the scope of my gaming experience, is that simple things that we should have known then. Women are not objects like in the James Bond films of that era.
Yes.
That people of other ethnicities are a delight to get to know and experience the gaming styles. They're not the people who bring you your check. No, they are compatriots. They are fellow gamers. And the hobby is so much incredibly more inclusive. Back in the 60s and 70s, this was a bunch of guys who were horny all the time and were turning to games as a release, okay? Tabletop gaming was their focus because they couldn't get dates. And this developed from Charles Roberts' creations of the 50s, becoming Avalon Hill, becoming the war game spinoffs into Avalon or SPI, Task Force. I mean, you know, I'm skipping hundreds of formative board game companies, but this all grew out of that then. And so we are accustomed to a very locker room attitude. You can joke about a locker room type talk that came up in the campaign, for example, but that stuff does go on. You just don't normally have a microphone running, okay? You're talking to like, hell, it even stops when the gym teacher comes around the corner, you know, that sort of stuff.
Right.
So that's leaked over to an extent. You learned, you knew how to behave in public, and you didn't let it leak too much, but there was a little bit of, you know, glances and whoa, you know, things when something was on the TV or you see a magazine. This atmosphere was definitely hostile to non-white, very often non-male, non-rich. We were all relatively privileged, and we've learned a lot about this, and I'm absolutely dead serious about this. It's a joy to me to discover that women can enjoy games.
Yeah,
I mean, it's great. My standard convention game is either half or nearly half female, and yes, I've had majority female games. I don't go looking for it either way. I take it as it comes. I don't tilt the topics either way, because the kind of topics that would offend anybody on a gender basis were never part of my gig anyway. You know,
right.
So but I don't look at it as, oh, who cares? It doesn't affect me, because it affects all of us as hobby gamers. You know, okay, I'm not the type who ever did anything like this. Cross my heart, I promise. Remember, my dad was pro Negro rights in the early 60s.
Right.
And I grew up with that kind of respect for other people, women, minorities, you name it. And so this is just ingrained in me, my sister, my family, but it's not in a lot of folks. And it's not in some people, older folks who are still out there gaming and coming to cons. We have learned to button it up, to just suck it up, some of this. No, you can't just blab like you used to in the country clubs and locker rooms, etc. I mean, it's offensive. And it would have been offensive then. If you were a decent person, you would have shut up if a woman walked into the room. Oh, no, you don't say this in front of, you know, the nice ladies. So you do have a sense of decency and propriety there. And we've just realized that when you're indecent and improper amongst yourselves, it then leaks out and taints the rest of your life. And if you keep it all straight, it works out so much the better all the way around. And you don't have to keep track of the old lie game. You know, who did I tell which lie to? I got to remember that I told him this. You don't even have to get into that game. And the same with excuses as far as gender or tolerance, things like that. I'm not one for political correctness as an excuse. And that can get into a whole different thing. But anyhow, just to just applause and love it for the way things are these days, and be able to go to cons. And you know, it's a good cross-section slice of America. I know one guy named Jamie who used to win Iron Game Master competitions. Iron GM was the competition. He happened to be a commercial truck driver. And some people running into him at a truck stop wouldn't have given him two glances and wouldn't have thought he was a gamer in any way, shape, or form. And he could beat the snockers off of me on certain games. And his wife is a tactician of a board gamer, you know, thanks to a little coaching on my part. But she enjoys going around, hey, want to play this cute game? Slice, shred. Okay, leave you sitting there in the chair. Well, play again.
I got to tell you.
No, I love it.
I was at OGC, which is a con that happens in the summertime up in the Northeast as well. One of the guys said to me, he says, you know, Blix, you're kind of like a ninja gamer. And I was like, I don't know what the hell does that mean? He's like, well, to look at you, you don't look like a gamer at all. Not even remotely would I ever guess that you were a gamer. He's like, but you're probably one of the biggest geeks in the room. Like, you know more about games and strategy. And he's like, you're just... like you don't fit what you look like. And I was like, well, I guess that's a compliment. I don't know, you know. But like you're saying, the truck driver, right? I mean, it's same kind of thing.
And on the other hand, end of the scale, since I've been around so long, people tend to want to talk to me, and I've accumulated a lot of junk over the years, so I know a lot of serious collectors. We'll just put it that way, on almost every continent. And some of these guys are the literal 1%, people who are pulling home, taking home $1 million a month or more, and they're still taking time out to game and to collect cool hobby gaming stuff. And I know people like this.
I have a
pretty good friend who's an oil man out of Calgary, Canada, who flies over to Africa and he arranges all these big. He takes time out to go to GaryCon and GenCon. You know,
wow, I mean,
it's really excellent. You know, it's for everybody is the point. Yeah. Not the super rich alone, not the super poor, not for all of us. The smart guys who turn into rules lawyers, and the other folks who get you when your back is turned because they got cleverness but not in your face smart, you know, that sort of thing. All types. We're all here, folks.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
You were saying about women in gaming too. My girlfriend is an avid D&D player. She plays with a group, and I've been lucky enough to play in their group, and it's mostly women. And watching women play male characters in that world is as best. You know, sociology lesson you could ever have, how they view the male, you know, psyche and how they make decisions is fascinating. And it's the most diverse game you can ever experience.
All right, Jack.
And don't ever forget that an all guys game takes on certain all guy things.
Yes.
And don't say it doesn't. You know, it does.
You're right.
It does.
You're right.
Same way. The same way. An all gals game, when it's all gals, including a female game master, takes on its own character. So there are functions. There are ways that all of these provide satisfaction and resolve something that we want, that we're looking for, some way to socialize and join together.
Yeah.
You know, hey, Jack, sometime I have to come over and play in your girlfriend's game, and I'll play a woman and see how different that is. It's like, okay, you gals are playing men. I'm going to play a woman. Let's see what this thing does. That.
Their group is mostly women, and I played a female character because they were all playing men, and it was probably the most fun we ever had in that campaign.
That's awesome.
It was great.
That's fantastic. Sweet. And Mike, you can play a transgender. That's right up your
if you wish.
Sure.
Why not? All right. So, hey. So, Frank, where can we find your stuff? What are you doing now? What are you promoting? Anything at all? Are you doing? You got anything going on right now?
Well, one brief flashback to set it up. In the aughts, when we had this commercial bakery, I started getting phone calls, and I was wondering what was going on. I was getting invited to this and to that, and I was illegally running baked goods down to the Gygax house in Lake Geneva from the Northwoods, you know, on a regular basis, you know, undercover of night. But I keep getting these invitations to game conventions, and it suddenly hit me that it's the 20th anniversary of Redbox, was in 06 and or 03. And the repercussions, like the 20th anniversary of the Italian and the German and the Japanese, you know, and so as these dominoes were falling out there and my name was coming up. And so I was getting out in public more. And so I put together new, I had left New Infinities years before in Gary, so that was kind of a surprise. But I called some friends and put together Eldritch, the new company, and we gave it a shot. But I still keep going to cons. And at Eldritch, we didn't produce our own game system. We did that deliberately. There are a lot of great systems out there. I just didn't see doing one having it get lost, you know, basically. Couldn't think of anything world-shaking to say or do, so no, don't need to get in there. But what I found myself doing is basically preaching the gospel of this community of hobby gamers that we have throughout the world. And in the course of all this and the response I got to that and seeing really good people like my friend Monty Cook he's getting along great with a crowd, and then he has to turn salesman and talk about Numenera or something and make his pitch. And I felt so bad for him having to go to the commercial side and not just be the great guy he is. And how blessed I am to be able to get out there and talk about the higher ideals and this community and not be stuck with the salesman's pitch. And it occurred to me, my epiphany was, why not start a nonprofit to serve hobby gaming worldwide? And we'll start with the U.S. Step one is find out what's already there and don't upset any apple carts. There are hundreds of gaming-related benefit organizations, regular events, things like that. Wow. First, we need a map, just like the old vintage 70s Dragon magazine tried to map the dungeons. They were trying to put together a list of all the game masters. We say nowadays, lots of luck. There were millions by the 80s. Yeah, but then, you know, that's a nice idea. Now we have the tools to do it with computer technology. Right. So I'm looking to put together a 501c3. We're going to file in Delaware. I'll have a board of advisors of anywhere from 7 to 18 people. That's being tossed around. But I am looking for leading figures from the old days, from the new days, etc. My only insistence is that it's all non-digital. It's all tabletop gaming is what we'll focus on. Somebody else wants to start one for all digital gaming? Great. But I think this might be my one great last great contribution, or even dwarfing Redbox, you know, which is now a fragment of history, and setting a stage of bringing everybody together here on a global basis. I've run into so many people on a global basis. I know the people are there and are interested. People are ready to translate things from English to other languages and vice versa to facilitate this on a volunteer basis. I can help make that happen. At the same time, I realize I don't have enough time. I'll be 67 this year. And realistically, if my head still works like this in a decade, I will be amazed. But I am probably going to start fading out. Okay. So there's a lot I need to do. And basically, it comes down to my top 10 of the 100 and 200 projects that I had left before I retired from game design. And so I am looking to spin these off as a design house. My LLC is called Loxley. And it has nothing to do with Robin Hood. It's the drunk who lived two blocks from Ben when he went out one night and with his crazy drunken kite experiment and said, I need a key to tie to this. And his friend Benjamin Loxley said, all right, use mine. They had been the bar with the tavern is right next to Loxley's place. So anyhow, that's the true story of Ben Franklin. And Loxley's key is my symbol, what the conduit for grabbing a little bit, one few last bits of lightning here, my creative ideas, the best, not throwing out 90% of my crap, but the best 10%, and trying to get those implemented, working with other people. I've talked to major authors, at least 5, 6, 8 other game companies. I don't want to publish something. I want to turn it over to them to publish. Why should I develop a company to publish with a network and distribution? No, I don't have time. I don't have the interest. And I don't care enough about money to go chasing it one last time. I'm happy to take a small slice, let other people enjoy the wealth. So keep your eyes open. I think within the next 2 years, you're going to see at least 3 or 4 projects of mine that everybody's going to hear about. Okay. From Kickstarter stuff to other straight up product releases. We'll see what happens. What I want to spend my time on, though, is triggering those, getting my ideas down, getting the balls moving, but without me doing the running. I'm not a running back anymore, okay? Right. Far from it. And I can quarterback a little, but mostly I want to help guide my vision of this nonprofit. Current working name, Project Gandalf. The awesome. Azir stood above Middle Earth. And they pissed off the dwarves and hobbits and everybody to no end by refusing to take sides and looking out for the whole shebang. And that's where I'm at. Not just board gamers, not just role players, not just card gamers, tile gamers, but all of us together. Right. And we leave our differences at the door and we will continue our humanity and our version of the arts by participating in our creative efforts through cooperative gaming, like role-playing, and then enjoying getting our frustrations out head-to-head in good cutthroat competitive gaming. Fantastic. And when you lose, you smile and you say, thank you, that was great.
Right.
Because that's how we do it.
So awesome. Could they, our community. Would it be good for them to follow you, say, on your Facebook page? Would that be just a good place to follow where, what you're doing on a, from here on?
I have around 3,500 friends on Facebook. I don't go with this thing of putting up a commercial page because I haven't been a commercial guy with a product to push for so long. It's not worth it. No, it's just Frank, just me. I do insist on a G to PG approach to my page. So it's a little island of sanity at times amidst the turbulent social media.
Yeah.
But no, you can't say shit on my page. You can say it here, but not there. Honest to gosh, and I kill, you know, weirdo links, far right, far left. I don't care. That's deep good. End stuff. No,
fair enough.
Talk about it elsewhere. But we talk politics, religion, all sorts of stuff there. Gamers taking a break from our games. Yeah. Amazing levels of communication that go on. If there's any news to come out and when there's any news, it'll come through any companies I'm working with. I already scored what I feel is a major license involving a famous motion picture star. Likeness, the works. And we're looking at, okay, how can we best utilize this resource in game applications and things like that? So that's in the works.
Oh, nice.
I'm looking at some digital projects that will enhance the tabletop experience.
Good. Okay.
This is an area I feel has been vastly overlooked. Every time they come out with new sound packages and stuff, I'm okay. I got to test all this. There's so much potential. The audio element of what's going on at the table. So I've got some R&D stuff going on here. Working with others. I've got the contacts on the West Coast and East Coast while I sit here in the heartland to make all this happen, and it's just wonderful.
Fantastic. All right, everybody. We'll keep an eye. Frank is doing some really cool stuff, and keep an eye out for his nonprofit. That's something that'll be nice for everybody, all gamers inclusive. What's that, Mike?
I got a quick question. One quick question, Frank. Just a short, real short, because I know we're running out of time. Where do you see gaming in 50 years? Like, where do you see it? Do you see? I'm going to allow you to right now to make a prediction. Like, you know, some weird thing, some new type of technology or an integration or hybridization of technologies that we don't even have right now. I mean, obviously computers and the internet is something current, but where do you see anything?
Last time I was in Italy, they asked me something similar, and I described a digital piece of art that used the kind of sensors they use to analyze reactions to commercials, fault track your eyes, your heat signature and things. And layers in the digital art changed so that the art changes so that you are the most satisfied with it.
That's a great idea.
The software could be there right now. It's art intensive, but with the capabilities of digital graphics and a really capable creator, something like that could mushroom out at any point. But that's near future stuff. In the technical end, I can't imagine it. It will probably involve a real light, non-obtrusive version of Tracy Hickman's Void or Oculus Rift or other virtual reality devices and environments, things like that. But one thing I'm sure of that we have discovered through the computer game age is that we get fascinated by toys and we go running outside and we play with our toys, but eventually we come home and tabletop gaming is where you're looking at real people and maintaining that digital contact, that tactile, the whole sensory experience, and not just the digital interface. And that will continue to be the home base as we move out and try these other new avenues, play with our new toys. We'll keep coming back to perhaps greatly digitally enhanced, like I said, audio environments, as well as the visuals that you could produce with, who knows if we'll make it to holograms. That's been theorized. We still are still not there. Yeah. So, but regardless of the tech, I'm sure that we'll keep coming back to each other.
Yep. Fantastic. Yep. I agree. I think so. I think you're spot on. All right, so, well, everybody, make sure you keep an eye on Frank. Frank, we'd like you to stick around for just a few more minutes. We have a game. Mike has put together, this is a fun, so Mike and I have talked, we've played different versions of this game many times. This is one of our most fun games. So I'm going to turn the show, I'm basically going to turn the show over to Mike at this point. So, Mike, take it away.
All right. Hey, everybody. Right now, we are going to play Star Wars Planet or Indian cuisine.
This is so awesome.
I am going to read for you the name of either a planet from the Star Wars universe or a tasty Indian cuisine. Either may sound tasty, but only one will your foot stand firmly on. Okay. So, Pete, my view of the cameras is different than you, but I'm going to go with Frank, then Jack, and then you. Okay?
Okay.
All right. Yes, so here we go. Starting with Frank. Frank, the first Star Wars planet or Indian cuisine is Farrokh Pax. Farrokh Pax.
Star Wars planet.
Farrokh Pax was a planet in which the battle was fought during the Galactic Civil War. It was once home of the kingdom of the ancient proto-species.
Nice. If they had put a D on the end, you would have had me. Farrokh Pax.
There you go. Okay, so Jack, this one is for you. Kutu.
That sounds like something delicious. So I'm going to go with Indian cuisine.
Kutu is a vegetable of dal or lentil mixture boiled in water. Very good.
Maybe not so delicious, but yes.
This is 1 point apiece, Pete, just by the way.
Yeah, gotcha. Yep, I'm down. Got it.
So here we go. Pete, for you, rasam.
That's definitely a dish. That's got to be an Indian dish, right?
Definitely a dish. All right. Rasam, a spicy and sour, usually made with tamarind, tomatoes, peppers, and other South Indian spices. All right. Back to you, Frank.
Exclusive to Tatooine, though. So.
It's a trick question.
So it's both, right?
All right. For you, Frank, is Sandesh, Indian cuisine or Star Wars planet?
I got to go with planet again.
Sandesh, a dessert of milk, sugar,
sugar,
Bengali dish. All right, moving on to Jack.
Yes.
Jalebi. Jalebi.
That's got to be the Star Wars planet, home of the Jalebes, right? Jalebi?
Well, you would think possibly if Jalebi were the species, Jalebi, the Jalebians. However, Jalebi is a sweet grained salmonella flour, baking powder, and curd sugar. Jalebi. I don't think your wife made Jalebi in her bakery, did she? Right.
No, we didn't even get into some very fine Mexican pastries that we've discovered since that period, moving further, way down south here to the northern Illinois area. We're back in Wisconsin now, but, you know, up Wisconsin Northwoods, it's, you know, everybody speaks Swedish, you know, and you see hodags running around the woods. And it's a weird place, but.
Not many Jalebians running around.
No.
Jalebia.
Peter.
Yes.
Florum. Now, just so you know, I have now done four pieces of tasty Indian cuisine in a row. The, my question for you is, am I actually dumb enough to do a fifth or not? Just to add some game theory and a layer of game. Florum.
Florum. See, you know, I could see this being like a writer creating a planet that's, you know, it's got a lot of plants on it, and like, what are you gonna call it? Florum. Let's do florum. Okay.
It's lazy.
Right?
Yeah.
Right. Lazy. Just like, you know, like some of the planets would be like aquia. It's like, oh, it's a water planet. Oh, really? Yeah. Shocker.
Right.
Florum. Everyone has really good teeth there.
Yeah. Right. You know what? Food. It's Indian food.
Florum was a sulfurous desert planet located in the
God damn it!
All right. In the Sitar sector of the galaxy's outer rim territories.
It's a sulfur planet named Florium?
That is correct. Sulfurous planet, yes. I know. I was as surprised as you were.
So it wasn't called Sulfa?
That is, I'm pretty sure. All right, Frank, back to you right now with Glee and Selm. Glee and Selm.
It rings a bell. I'm going to go with dessert again.
All right, Glee and Selm was an ocean planet located in the rim region of the galaxy. Glee
I love this game. It's so unpredictable. It's like there's no way. It's like it's just guessing.
Yeah, there's no way to know.
Earlier, I said I think I found out where the writers of the Star Wars universe where they had lunch every day.
Yeah, in Libya or Liberia or wherever they were, Tunisia. That's right.
Yes. Tunisia.
All right. We're at Jack. Jack. Yep. Yours is Sev Tameta. Sev
Tameta.
Come on. Tameta, right? It's tomato, right?
Right, right. It's got to be. I'm going to go with the, since it's a guess, I'm just going to go reverse game theory. And since they've all been planets lately, I got to go in tomato food. It's Indian. Indian
Sev,
food.
Sev Tameta. Veggie, potatoes, and Sev.
Wait, you said tomato, not potato.
I know.
You say potato, they say tomato.
Potato, tomato, whatever. All right. Peter, your next one is Iru Diru. Iru.
It's right here.
Planet that technically means diarrhea.
Right. That's definitely going to be Indian food then. Irodiru. Goddamn. I'm going to say planet? Planet?
Irodiru was a planet in the galaxy's Irodiru system. Okay. Frank?
Must I?
We've only got a couple more, right, Mike?
Yeah, we got a couple more. Vashka.
Who?
It's not a who, but definitely a what. But the question is, do you walk on it or do you put it in your mouth? Vashka.
One more time.
Vashka.
Vashka.
V-A-S-H-K-A. And I only give you the spelling because... You deserve it.
Well, yeah. Help. Somebody said that to me on an alley in St. Petersburg, Russia once. And no, I'm going to wrongly switch to a planet and it'll turn out food again. But I'll go with planet.
Vashka was a planet in the galaxy. It was covered in trees and mountains with small towns dotting the edge of the planet's seas.
Okay.
I don't know why they decided. I mean, if it was such an important place, I don't know why they had to dot it with just a few towns. But okay. So that was all right. So we can make this the last round. We'll get the score at the end of this round, and then we'll find out.
Okay. And if we need to do a tiebreaker, we'll do a tiebreaker.
Okay. So we're moving on to Jack. Razgula.
No.
Oh, he's from Batman.
Yeah.
<I know>. Batman villain for 3 points.
Ras Gula. That's got to be a dish. I can just see that on a menu.
Well, then you would be having a dessert of cottage cheese, flour, and sugar syrup, a signature Bengali condiment, and it originated in Odisha.
What planet is Odisha on?
It's the Odisha system in the Middle Rim.
Right.
Okay. Peter.
I'll tell you what, you'd be worried about your middle rim if it was too hot.
Yes. But it's a dessert, so we're good. So yours, Peter, is Momo.
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 Planet.
Mm-mm. Like to put some Momo in my mouth because it's originally from Tibet and it's a popular dumpling snack in India. Ooh.
All right, Mike.
Like Peter, our score?
We can call it a game. You want to call it the game? We have a winner.
Sure.
All right. So Frank and Pete tie for 2 points. And this week, Jack, what the hell, man?
Two in a row.
Jack is our winner. Oh. Good job, Jack. Thank you. Wow. So, hey, Mike, what does he win?
He wins a big bowl of puru.
Hey, what was that one with seasoned ants? You remember that one from last time?
That was bizarre candies. Bizarre.
All right. Well, Mike, thanks. Fuck, a great game. Another good one. We're going to do this with tasty cheeses again. I like the tasty cheeses one, too.
I'll give you a tasty cheese coming your way next.
You would not believe how many types of freaking cheese there are.
Yeah, I do one called Star Wars Species or Tasty Cheesies.
It's good, too. It's really good. All right. I am going to run the closer. Frank, thanks for joining us. I really, appreciate you coming on. Fantastic. Hang on for just a second. And I'm going to do this. You've just enjoyed another awesome episode of the MythWits. Special thanks goes out to Frank Mentzer. Keep an eye on him. He's doing some cool stuff coming up. Watch us live on Twitch Mondays at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time. Jump into the chat room and ask our guest questions. We didn't see anybody in there this week, but you know, hey guys, come on. I know we moved to Twitch recently, but you know, keep up. If you miss our live show, you can always catch the encore episode on YouTube/MythWits. Find us at MythWits.com and on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Twitch, and SoundCloud, all as the MythWits. Do the like, follow, subscribe thing wherever it's appropriate. Please give us a bunch of stars and a review on iTunes. Screenshot that. We'll post it on our Facebook page, and I will personally send you something special. And it won't be my underwear. It'll be something else, like a card or something. I don't know. I'll make an adventure for you. Something. I don't know. MythWits is part of this TSR Podcast Network. If you like us, you're bound to like the other great shows there as well. Make sure to check out TSRPN.com. MythWits is a Creative Commons product. Make sure to share it and all that kind of stuff. Just don't try to make money with it. Studio97.com is the place to find some more cool stuff of ours. Thanks, everybody, for listening. Tell your friends to tune in. Please tell your friends to tune in. We need more listeners. And to that end, Mike?
You guys think that they eat jalebi on Florum?
You think?
No.